All right, hello and welcome to another Expert Inside interview. My name is John Golden from SalesPOP, online sales magazine and Pipeliner CRM. And today I'm joined by Rúna Bouius, who is up in Los Angeles. How are you doing, Rúna?
I'm doing well, thank you, John.
Excellent. And I'm down here in San Diego as usual. But to be honest, we have to be honest, Rúna is originally from Rackwick in Iceland. And as you know, I'm originally from Dublin in Ireland. So, you know, we're both from over there somewhere. And as we were laughing before we came on air, sometimes Iceland and Ireland gets confused. They're spelled very similar.
Yep.
But we do share many historical, cultural phenomena together, both Iceland and Ireland. So it's interesting.
Yep.
So today we're going to talk about conscious leadership. So, Rúna, when you work with CEOs and companies and you talk about this or introduce this idea of conscious leadership, what do you mean by that?
What I mean by that is that where we are in the world today, the mm-hmm. old way of leading, which has very much be hierarchical, one at the top and leading down gradually to the masses, mm-hmm. doesn't seem to be working so well anymore. And there is an emerging trend coming in where we could really say where the power structure is shifting away from hierarchy, which often has been mentioned in the same word as patriarchy. Or more masculine, logical way of leading, command and control, for instance, very militaristic way of leading, doesn't seem to be serving us very well. We have used this. We have used our control to take, whether it's from the earth or in a way from our people, use the people in the organizations like cogs in a wheel. And I nearly want to say kind of explode them. And that is kind of, I think, coming to an end. And we need to find a new way of being because this system isn't sustainable. People mm-hmm. are not happy in organizations. They feel enslaved. And in today's world, if companies really want to attract the best talent and keep the best talent, they really have to find a different way of engaging their people. And particularly the young people, they are not accepting the old way of doing business, the hierarchy. Mm-hmm.
Well, I think there's a number of phenomena that's going on. And I think part of it, too, is if you like, the democratization of work. Because if you look at the world today, because of technology and interconnectedness, et cetera, is that certainly when it comes to knowledge working or specific skills or whatever, you can pretty much engage with somebody anywhere in the world, right? So it's opened up the whole global access to resources. So in many ways, it's forcing organizations to think differently because no longer, as you say, is it a question of putting up a building and gathering everybody together in one place. Now people are going to, the best talent is going to be wherever the best talent wants to be.
Exactly. Exactly. So, and that's why it's also very important to think about how we used to be very competitive. And now there is so much more talk about collaboration, and we have to do that. We have to learn how to collaborate when people within an organization are all over the planet. Mm-hmm. So collaboration is really important.
And not just people in the organization, working with people like external to the organization, because one of the other phenomena we're seeing is that there's a lot of, most companies, there's a lot of tasks that come up that require specific expertise, but they don't come up all the time. So you're not going to hire somebody with that specific expertise. You're going to contract them when you need them. So we have teams now of both internal to the company, maybe they're virtual and distributed across the globe. And then maybe there's people external to the organization who you also have to lead in these teams at the same time.
Exactly. Exactly. So in a way, what this requires is for each person to be much more self-relying on we could say self-organizing. That's really mm-hmm. what is emerging, that self-organization, giving autonomy to the people and trusting that people will do their work. even though they're in different places or just come in, not as a full-time employee, but just for a gig.
Yeah. But on the flip side of that, though, there comes with obviously there comes the responsibility on the part of the individual to have a high level of self-accountability, right? Yep. Because it's not all one way. It's not if you can't like delegate and make a matrix and very flat organization or whatever. If the people that you're allowing to operate in a more flexible way, if they don't have a certain level of responsibility.
Absolutely. I think that's where really conscious leadership comes in, because what that kind of asks for is for individuals to take on or to commit to the leadership development or leadership journey, as I often talk about it. And I think where we are in the world today, we all need to be learning. There is absolutely no exception. Having growth mindset and committing to being a lifelong learner is part of it. And also, we are learning so much about skills and external skills, but this really requires also internal skills to build up our inner core and in a way, getting guidance also from the inside, mm-hmm. not just from the external.
Yeah, and it's interesting, though, as you said, that I agree with you, people need to be lifelong learners. But unfortunately as well, there is a pervasive culture that has come about that everything should be easy, simple, quick. You shouldn't have to like invest a lot of time or energy. Everything should be made easy. So there's two forces at work here. There's one where there's, as I said, there's this pervasive culture of simplicity and everything is easy and you shouldn't have to. And the other side, there is, if people are going to be self-reliant or self-accountable and self-leadership, they have to learn things don't come easy, right? It's not, things don't actually come easy.
Well, I think we have to work for it. It's, mm-hmm. it. Maybe we could say self-mastery, and anyone who has studied mastery, whether it's in sports or in art or music, the more you practice, the better you become. Mm-hmm. And there is no exception. If you're learning to ski, the more rounds you go, the better skier you're going to be. Mm-hmm. So with that in mind, I think we have to commit to doing the work that it takes to get into self-mastery. But I think the more we are aligned with who we are and why we are here, what is the purpose of me being here at this time, and also aligned with potentially a purpose that is bigger than ourselves, purpose that serves the collective. If you have alignment to that, then I think things kind of work themselves out in a smoother way than if we are always trying to kind of swim upstream in resistance. Mm-hmm. So that's being flexible, being adaptable, being pliable. And that's so needed in this world of complexity and chaos and uncertainty that we are experiencing in the world today.
Yeah, and the other part too is that it's difficult nowadays for, I mean, as you talked about younger people coming into the workforce, you know, they're saying like the millennials stay maybe 2 years in an organization. I think that's what the statistics show. You know, they move around a lot, which is fine. So you have to adapt also to the fact that you're going to have people you've got to get who aren't maybe going to commit for 5 or 10 years like maybe people did before. So you've got to figure out how you can bring them on board quickly, have the most positive experience on both sides, and accept that yes, you have to have an organization that's going to be able to cycle people kind of quickly.
Yeah, absolutely. And also, the more opportunities you might give these young people, the more hope there is that they stay if you don't give them an opportunity to grow and to develop and take on new tasks, they are going to leave. There's no question about that.
So how do you advise an organization that maybe has been very traditional in the way that it's operated and it wants to start that journey to maybe becoming a bit of a more flexible, more fluid organization?
Yeah, I think I would try to sell them the idea that no one is exempt. So many organizations have brought in consultants and experts to do change management. Mm-hmm. They come up with new systems and new structures and all of that, and nothing changes. And right, to me, that is because what's missing is that the people in the organization change. And you can't order people to change, but you can offer them and invite them opportunities and make it interesting for them to want to learn and to grow and to take on that inner change. And they are not only going to benefit from that in the workplace, but that is for absolutely for sure going to improve their relationships with their family, with their partners, with themselves, of course, and with anyone else. So conscious leadership is very much about kind of taking responsibility for your own leadership journey and not just look at your boss to fix you or to blame everybody else for everything that goes wrong. It's really about taking responsibility, looking at your own reality, where you might be stuck, where you might be limiting your thinking, the way you see things, your perspective, having very small glasses on, and really start to explore, become curious. I think curiosity is a really big thing, trying to get people to become curious about who they are and how they function, what their gifts and talents are, where is their genius, and then start to become curious about the other people that they work with so you can start to look at, okay, as a team, where is our strength? How can we best use of everybody's genius to really go after the vision that this company has and give people that opportunity also to be the best that they can be, to step into full potential?
Yeah, I really like what you said there, because it is true. It says that if you say to most people, say accountability, you say to most people, everybody needs to be more accountable. Most people would say, yes, everybody needs to be more accountable. But they always mean other people as opposed to themselves, right? They always think accountability starts with other people as opposed to, it has to start with yourself. And that idea of leadership too, it's we in this company have done a lot of study on Friedman Malik's leadership framework, and he does the first level of leadership is self leadership, right? Yeah, as you said, and that's the thing that most people overlook. Yeah. And I love also what you said about investing in yourself, because that always, I always struggle with that, where people say, I'm waiting for the company to invest in me, or I'm waiting for the leader to invest, and you're thinking, at the end of the day, nobody cares as much about your career as you do, or your life as you do. So maybe you should start with investing in yourself.
Exactly. And also about your well-being. Because how many people are suffering from stress and anxiety and burnout? Mm-hmm. How much does that cost organizations today? Well-being is starting to become a really big issue. And actually our two countries, Ireland and Iceland, are part of that, and New Zealand, they're really leading the way by creating a special budget within the government budget for well-being. Mm-hmm. So that well-being and wellness is popping up, not just as some programs in organization that no one wants to join, but really start looking at how are people feeling in the workplace. Mm-hmm. And mental health is coming into the discussion as well. So I think that's going to be one of the next frontier, and that's a very big part of conscious leadership, is to be proactive with how you feel. So it's about becoming conscious of your thinking, of your feeling, your emotions, of your beliefs. What do I believe in? And are these beliefs true, or might they be outdated now? Is it something I picked up in my home country and doesn't serve me because I have evolved and I see the world in a different way now? And the story we tell ourselves.
Yes.
Are we telling ourselves a victim story, or are we creating a new story that is much more about where we want to go and who we want to be, how we want to show up in the world? Mm-hmm. It's all in our power
No, 100% agree. I think it would be great if going into 2020 that everybody took a step back and had a look at themselves and, as you say, figure out who am I really, what do I really believe in, is this really what I want to do? At the end of the day, we all have choices. I think that's the other thing, is that we all have choices, right? Most people have choices. Most people aren't forced to do what they're doing. Or live the life that they're living. And I think at some stage you have to take a step back and say, I'm responsible for my reality, right? I'm responsible for where I am. If I don't like this, then it's down to me to change it.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And that's that was a moment in my life after 20 years as an entrepreneur in Iceland.
Mm-hmm.
I kind of felt like, this has been a great ride. I've learned so much. And I love my people and my clients and mm-hmm. everything we have created, but I'm ready for something more. There has to be something more. And I didn't know what that something more was, but I knew I had to go and look for that. And now I know that something more was, in a way, a deeper purpose.
Right.
Which I think is, as you have probably heard, it's a big topic in leadership today, and it's your own personal purpose and the purpose of the mm-hmm. company, but it is there because it's really important. And when we start to ask those questions, why am I here and what is my purpose, then we start to get a glimmer of where we might want to guide ourselves. Mm-hmm. What is it that really gives me joy and makes my heart sing?
Yeah.
And if that is something totally different than the work you are in, maybe you want to go back to school or take an evening to do something to guide yourself towards that.
And I think the other part is it's good to take a look at whatever you're doing and whatever you're striving for, is to make sure that that's what you want and you're not doing it because you think that's what's expected of you, or you're striving for someone else's dream, not your own. Right.
That's right. That's why one of my programs is called The New Vision. And that's literally inviting people to examine their story mm-hmm. and the vision that they have of their life, and help them to think bigger, to really mm-hmm. go for maybe forgotten dreams that they wanted, being a writer or being whatever it is, that everyone has something that they long to do, but they put it aside because it was more practical to go to university or whatever it was that they ended up doing.
Yeah. Or even go smaller. Or maybe it's just that, rather than killing yourself to strive for some, big position and everything, in fact, you want to focus more on your family and other things like that. But maybe you feel like it's expected of you to do this, right? So, whether it's bigger or whether it's downside or whatever, it's just find what you really, really want. Don't live out somebody else's expectations.
I think that's so important. It's what makes you happy and what works mm-hmm. for you, regardless of anybody else. And that's really part of conscious leadership, to help people to come back to themselves and take ownership of who they are and who they want to be, and be okay with that and not compare themselves constantly with other people, because we are all completely unique and have unique gifts and talents and interests.
Mm-hmm.
And why wouldn't we go for that? Why wouldn't we want to make use of that uniqueness?
Yeah, and I love that what you just said. I just wrote it down there. Come back to yourself, because I do think that's really important. And my late father used to always quote James Joyce, where you said living at arm's length from yourself.
Yeah.
So it's like always living a little bit away from yourself, or in a little bit too much in the future, whatever. But I like that about coming back to yourself and actually looking at who you really are, where you want to be, what really makes you happy.
Yeah, I wish this would be taught to us in school.
Mm-hmm.
Because it would make all it would be so much, the preparation for life would be so very different instead of having to kind of go back to the design table. But that's part of kind of us growing up and taking ownership of who we are.
Yeah. Well, it wasn't taught in my school, I'll tell you that much. We had a very different education system back in the old days in Ireland. So thankfully it's progressed a little bit since then.
System, yeah.
Yeah. So listen, Rúna, this has been fascinating. But before we go, I'd like you to tell people a little bit more about the kind of work that you do.
Right. So I help progressive leaders and visionary leaders, meaning leaders who are interested in finding out what conscious leadership is or what interested in knowing how to be the best leader possible in the 21st mm-hmm. century, kind of upgrading their leadership skills. So I help them by coaching, by mentoring, consulting with teams and organizations. I design and facilitate workshops and retreats for teams or for small groups. I speak. I'm available to speak to companies and to audiences. And I write, so people can read some of the things that I write. And I also, I'm starting to do more of being on advisory boards, which is very exciting.
Excellent. And what do you do in your spare time? Because you don't have any spare time, right? After that list.
Right. I love to be out in nature as much as I can. Mm-hmm. So walking, even though I'm kind of handicapped at the moment, I have an injured foot, so I can't walk. But walking every day is part of my game. Cultivate relationships with friends and family. I have a little grandson, which is my delight. I have play days with him. So that's my big fun, going back to being a kid.
Yeah, and I do think, and this is just my little bit of pontification before we go. I just think there's so much going on in the world. There's so much negativity. There's so much anger, or what somebody described recently as recreational anger. It seems, you know, where people almost like they enjoy like fighting on social media. If people just came back to being the best person they can be the best partner, spouse, whatever, the best parent, the best person in your small community, the world would be such a greater place, and leave all of that nonsense aside.
I agree with you. Make it beautiful and make it beautiful and be kind.
Mm-hmm. Well, listen, Rúna, this has been great. My name is John Golden from SalesPOP, online sales magazine and Pipeliner CRM. I'll see you all for another expert interview really soon. Thank you.
Thank you, John.